Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Insects, A Very Short Introduction by Simon Leather, narrated by Gareth Richards. Publisher's note: this audiobook contains references to visuals present in the print and ebook editions of the book. Foreword. This is a special book, the culmination of Simon's 60-year passion for insects, both as a hobby and a profession. His aim was to bring the wonder of insects to a wider audience, so he was delighted to have the opportunity to write this very short introduction, VSI. Simon spent his early life in the tropics and fell in love with insects as a child in Jamaica. He wanted to find out how insects worked and how they behaved. He studied agricultural zoology at Leeds University, where he discovered a passion for aphids, then completed a PhD at the University of East Anglia, UEA, studying the ecology of the bird cherry oat aphid. Two short postdoctoral fellowships followed, one in Finland, developing a prediction system for the same aphid, another back at UEA. For 10 years he worked for the Forestry Commission, based in Roslyn Midlothian, researching and advising on forest pests, particularly the pine beauty moth and the large pine weevil. But he missed academia, and was pleased to be appointed as a lecturer at Imperial College London, based at the Silwood Park campus, where for 20 years he lectured and conducted research on agricultural, horticultural, and forest pests. He discovered the joy of urban ecology, researching the biodiversity of Bracknell's infamous roundabouts, which later inspired the name of his blog, Don't Forget the Roundabouts. In 2012, he was delighted to move with his team to Harper Adams University, HAU, where he was proud to be appointed as the first UK professor of entomology. He spent 9 happy years at HAU, basking in the collegiality, interacting with colleagues from all disciplines, and most particularly, with students. He just loved to share his passion and to support and mentor the next generation of entomologists. He realized that social media could enhance science communication by reaching a far wider audience, and joined the Twitter sphere at EntoProf, tweeting and retweeting all things entomological and ecological, but also personal. His walks and footpaths that needed repair, the view from home, France, where he hoped to retire, Brexit, COVID, Sunday roasts, and much more. He built up a following of almost 10,000 people, many of whom knew him only virtually. He also started a blog, Don't Forget the Roundabouts, posting at about 10-day intervals for the rest of his life, on a myriad of subjects, often his beloved aphids, but anything that piqued his interest. Insect idioms, e.g. a gnat's whisker, tidy desks, not his own, the dearth of entomologists, insects in children's literature, classical entomological equipment, family history, papers that influenced his thinking and books that he enjoyed, dead entomologists, Insectageddon, together with a regular pick and mix of links that he thought worth sharing. He wrote natural history haikus and illustrated some blogs with hand-drawn cartoons. Indeed, many of his blogs were mini papers, supported by data, graphs, figures, and references. He expounded on institutional vertebratism, a term that he coined to describe the concentration of effort and funding towards conserving vertebrates, often furry animals, at the expense of vastly more numerous and more important invertebrates. Had he not been an entomologist, Simon might have been a writer. He was a voracious reader, owning 10,000 books, all of which he had read, and writing generally came easily to him. He published well over 200 papers and wrote or edited a number of books. He served as an editor or editorial board member for various ecological journals over many years and refereed countless papers. He founded the Leather Family History Society, to foster research into his family name, writing articles and books to document what he and others discovered. Simon was convivial. He seemed to know everyone in the world of entomology. Wherever he worked, he engaged with colleagues, enjoying coffee room chats. He loved meetings and conferences, getting together with colleagues who became friends, sharing meals and a beer or preferably glass of red wine. As a fellow ecologist said, he was the first person to look for at conferences. As part of his outreach, he developed a suite of entertaining talks to engage groups such as the University of the Third Age, U3A, gardening societies, and the Women's Institute, WI. He contributed to summer schools, careers fairs, and initiatives such as Skype a Scientist to enthuse young people about insects. Simon was an honorary fellow of the Royal Entomological Society, recognizing his outstanding contributions to entomology. In retirement, Simon planned to synthesize everything that he had learned about insects and to share this knowledge as widely as possible. Sadly, this book is his swan song. He died in September 2021, not long after the manuscript was accepted for publication. In his last blog post, he described the difficulty of writing this VSI, as he found that he knew both too much and not enough about insects. But while it was frustrating, it was also one of his most satisfying pieces of writing. I just hope that my readers will find as much to enjoy as I have since I first came across insects just over 60 years ago. I hope so too. Hugely grateful to Professor Helen Roy, MBE Ons, FRES, Ecological Entomologist at the UK Centre for Ecology and Hydrology, for stepping in to see this book through to publication. Dr. Gillian Leather. Preface. Insects are a wonderfully diverse group, but they are all animals with an exoskeleton, a supporting skeleton on the outside, made of the protein chitin. A three-part body plan, head, thorax, abdomen, three pairs of jointed legs, compound eyes, and one pair of antennae. They probably comprise 75% of all animal life. They range in size from tiny parasitic wasps, Dicopomorpha egmeterigis, a mere 139 micrometer long, to the titan beetle, Titanus giganteus, which can reach 17.5 centimeters. Insects are found on all continents and habitats, from the hottest deserts to the frozen Antarctic, in caves, in the soil, inside plants, in other insects and vertebrates, in watercourses and bodies of water, and in the watery interiors of pitcher plants. While no insects live beneath the waves, the intrepid sea skaters, bugs in the genus halibates, skim the surface of some oceans. Insects include predators, parasites, herbivores, detritivores, fungivores, and saprozoilics that live on decaying wood. Some are regarded as pests, while others are valued as beneficial. Some live colonially in a highly complex caste system. Others live solitary lives, mingling only to mate or overwinter. Some, such as the honeybee and the silk moth, have been domesticated for millennia. Others are used for biological control and protect our crops. Many provide highly nutritious, healthy food sources for humans. Some are excellent vectors of plant and animal disease. Others have been used in human medicine, for instance in maggot therapy and in the treatment of children with mental health issues and adults suffering from forms of dementia. They have inspired artists, sculptors, poets, musicians, novelists and engineers, and provide the shock element in many horror films. Their images have appeared on postage stamps and banknotes. Their preserved forms, framed under glass, adorn many a household's walls. Their rigid exoskeleton and associated musculature endow insects with great strength relative to their size, while their rapid reproductive rates and adaptability have allowed many species to evolve resistance to commonly used insecticides. Many species have an intimate and obligate relationship with symbiotic bacteria, that allows them to use food sources such as wood, phloem and xylem sap that other animals are unable to exploit. Their nervous system may be simple compared with that of mammals, but they exhibit parental care, respond to complex visual and olfactory signals, migrate thousands of miles, feel, or at least react to pain, and learn from experience. Many are masters of disguise, mimicking more well-defined species. Others sequester toxic chemicals from their host plants to protect themselves against predators, while yet others disguise themselves as living or dead plant parts, or blend so well into the background that is only when they move that they reveal their true nature. New species are described every day, and many more await discovery, even in well-studied parts of the world. Climate change and habitat degradation threaten the existence of tens of thousands of species, the consequences of which will almost certainly be detrimental to ecosystems worldwide. We know much about insects, and yet there is also much we do not know. Although there are only approximately 5,500 species of mammals, the mammal-biased perception of the animal kingdom has led to imbalances in funding and research at the expense of other, more specious, vertebrate groups, such as the reptiles, circa 10,000 species, and fish, over 30,000 species. This is, however, dwarfed by the dearth of funding and the paucity of researchers devoted to the study of insects, entomology, and other invertebrates. More than 1 million insect species have been described, with probably at least another 5 to 8 million species waiting to be named. Given the diversity, utility, and beauty of the insect world, this is a calamity. Insects are the bedrock on which human civilization rests. Without them, there would almost certainly be no humans. In the words of W.C. Alley, 1938, in his excellent book The Social Life of Animals, "A survey such as I am attempting here should not try to be exhaustive." I have taken his words to heart. Entomology is a vast subject, and I have had to admit a great deal. I have based this book on the facts about insects that I have taught to students over the past 30 years, with the aim of telling a story that conveys the wonder and awe that insects have inspired in me. I hope that you, the listener, will share my feelings of excitement about these wondrous animals. Chapter 1. In the Beginning. Arthropods are, with good cause, often described as the most diverse and successful group of animals in the world. As well as insects, they include spiders, millipedes, scorpions, shrimps, crabs, woodlice, and, perhaps surprisingly to many, the barnacles. The word arthropod is derived from the term arthropodization, hardened, sclerotized appendages with rings of soft, unsclerotized cuticle in between, in contrast to animals with soft cuticles. The word arthropod can be translated as jointed foot. Arthropods are also characterized by tagmata, functionally and structurally distinct batches of segments. In the case of the hexapoda, there are three: head, thorax, and abdomen. The body of an arthropod is covered by a chitinous exoskeleton, to which the body parts and muscles are attached internally. Arthropods shed their exoskeletons to grow, a process known as molting. After molting, the arthropod expands its body by swallowing or taking in air to fill the new skeleton before it hardens. Once the adult stage is reached, molting stops, and there is no further growth. Their success can be attributed to their very adaptable body plan. The evolution of many types of appendage, antennae, claws, wings, and mouthparts, has allowed arthropods to occupy nearly every niche and habitat on Earth. Animal life began in the oceans and remained there for hundreds of millions of years, until, about 500 million years ago, MYA, an arthropod left the water to live on land. This was the first of many. Fossil evidence shows that arthropods invaded the land several times, and that different groups, including the ancestors of the first insects and their closest relatives, the entognatha, made the ocean-to-land transition at different times. Within the phylum Arthropoda sits an extremely specious and successful group of organisms, the class Insecta. Insects are six-legged organisms, or hexapods, and are further nested within the pancrustacea, alongside the non-hexapod arthropods, like crabs and shrimps, possessing as they do chitinous exoskeletons and jointed appendages. The word insect is derived from the Latin insectum, notched or divided body. The class Insecta is well defined. All living insects arose from a common ancestor, which was a six-legged creature with a three-segmented body, jointed legs, and a single pair of antennae. These antennae helped the early land colonists to navigate around their new environment using chemical cues. The ancestors of insects were probably cave-dwelling crustacea, the Remipedia, and as they diversified, several groups emerged around 479 million years ago. The non-insect hexapods, the coneheads, springtails, and two-pronged bristletails, can often be found in damp habitats like soil, whereas the earliest true insects, the jumping bristletails and silverfish, were already more adventurous by the time they appeared on the scene around 440 million years ago. Two pairs of wings opened up a three-dimensional world as insects took to the air 406 million years ago. Some of the descendants of these first winged insects, the dragonflies, damselflies, and mayflies, still return to the water for breeding. But in the case of dragonflies and damselflies, they dominate local airspace as voracious predators. From then on, there was relentless diversification and constant adaptation as they tracked the evolution of flowering plants. Other advances, for example, transitioning from continuous development to a life cycle involving a pupal stage, allowed insects to reorganize their cells so that the adult insect was barely recognizable when compared with the larval form. This remarkable ability was something that confused many of the early entomologists, who often mistakenly described larval and adult forms as different species. The evolution of sociality, Chapter 4, allowed some insects to develop complex societies involving a redistribution of roles within the colony. Throughout their tenure on land, insects have been masters at interacting with other organisms, and are found both consuming and pollinating plants, gaining sustenance as detritivores, carnivores, or even feeding off the living tissue of their prey. Their myriad adaptations and tight integration with other life on Earth have been key determinants of their success. Bernard Misoff from Zoologische Forschungsmuseum, Alexander Koenig, based in Bonn, and a host of colleagues from around the world recently produced an extremely detailed classification of insects based on genetics combined with an analysis of fossil records. The phylogenetic trees, showing the relationship between organisms based on comparison of their DNA that they produced, are far too complicated for this book, but are summarized simply in Figure 1 and the accompanying text, which can be found in the print and ebook editions of this book. To reiterate, insects are six-legged arthropods, which are now grouped as members of the subphylum Hexapoda, which includes the Colymbola, Protura, and Diplura, now all placed within the class Entognatha, in reference to the fact that their mouthparts, unlike those of insects, are retracted within the head. The insects, which greatly outnumber the Entognatha, are grouped in the class Insecta, and are ectognathous, their mouthparts are exposed. Despite their superficial resemblance to arachnids, such as spiders, the nearest relatives to the hexapoda are the crustaceans, from which they diverged somewhere in the middle of the Ordovician period, some 460 MYA. Insects have lived on Earth for almost 500 million years, possibly even longer, as recent discoveries suggest that they arose in the Ordovician period and were well established by the Silurian, which began some 440 MYA. Fossil insects in amber from the Cretaceous period, 145 to 66 MYA, are very common. But many insect fossils are also found in shale deposits from the mid-Triassic, around 220 MYA, as well as the Silurian. Based on the structure and function of their respiratory system, which is based on an air exchange system, and the fossil record, it was assumed that the first insects were terrestrial. Extensive molecular genetic analysis has confirmed this, and it is now accepted that insects arose from cave-dwelling crustacea, derived from an earlier aquatic crustacean ancestor. Modern aquatic insects represent those that have returned to their ancestral habitat. Perhaps counterintuitively to us as relatively large mammals, the small size of insects is one of the reasons for their success. Most insects have a body size from 1 to 10 millimeters, allowing them to exploit many habitats that would otherwise be inaccessible. Some leaf miners can complete their whole development within a single leaf. The evolution of flight, their diversity of feeding habits, and their flexible life cycles allowed insects to conquer first the land and then the air. The position of insects within the animal kingdom. Kingdom, Animalia. Phylum, Arthropoda. Clade, Pancrustacea. Subphylum, Hexapoda. Class, Insecta. Structure and function. The head of insects, even in the apparently soft-bodied orders, is heavily sclerotized. The thorax is divided into three segments: the pro, meso, and metathorax, and the abdomen can have up to 12 segments. Not all insects have wings and legs. Larval stages never have wings, and some, depending on where they live, also lack legs. But where present, legs and wings arise from the thorax, with one pair of legs on each segment. In the case of winged insects, the forewings arise from the metathorax and the hindwings from the mesothorax. The outer skeleton, the cuticle, has two layers: the epicuticle, a thin, waxy, water-resistant outer layer covering the lower, much thicker, chitinous layer, the procuticle. This, in turn, is formed of two layers: the outer exocuticle and the inner endocuticle. The tough but flexible endocuticle is formed of several layers of fibrous chitin and other proteins. The exocuticle, also made of chitin, is rigid and hardened, sclerotized, although in many soft-bodied insects it is much thinner, especially in the larval stages. Insects are the only invertebrates that have developed the ability to fly. Wings, formed of outgrowths of the exoskeleton, are a feature of adult insects. The wings are strengthened by struts, veins, that divide them into segments, cells. Wing venation in insects ranges from the multi-celled, multi-veined complexity of the lace wings to the simplified, yet extremely efficient wing of the housefly. Each cell and vein has a unique designation, enabling the taxonomist to distinguish among species and orders. Ancestrally, insects have two pairs of wings, but some have reduced the size of their hind or forewings, as in the diptera, flies, and stresiptera, to such an extent that they are no longer functional for flight, but are used in a manner akin to a gyroscope. Some insects, such as the vine weevil, Otiorhynchus sulcatus, have lost the ability to fly altogether. Others, including aphids, only have wings at certain stages of their life cycle. Insects do not have lungs. Their respiratory system is based on a network of tubes called tracheae, analogous to the inner structure of the vertebrate lung. The tracheal system opens to the atmosphere through a series of thoracic and abdominal pores, spiracles, often visible to the naked eye. The insect can control the aperture of the spiracles in response to environmental conditions, and some can close them completely to prevent the entry of parasitic nematode worms. The tracheae branch into smaller and smaller tubes, the tracheoles, as they pervade the insect body, delivering oxygen to the various organs, in some cases almost directly to the mitochondria, the structures within cells that provide them with their energy. Although giant insects are often featured in horror stories and films, and in the past some insects were indeed much larger than those we encounter today, insects are limited in size because of the way in which they breathe. Lacking lungs, they depend on the diffusion of oxygen across the thin skin of the tracheoles. Larger insects ventilate their tracheal system by muscular pumping of the body walls, but even this does not compensate for the lack of lungs. The exoskeleton also brings with it some disadvantages, in that the surface weight ratio means that the integument, the insect's covering, becomes disproportionately heavy and susceptible to water loss. Giant arthropods are found only in water, although somewhat perversely, the largest insects are land-living. Unlike us, insects do not have veins and arteries or a single circulatory pump. Instead, a system of muscular pumps moves the hemolymph, a watery fluid, usually colourless.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.